All right, Susan.
Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Hi, good morning. I'm Suzanne, horticulturist here at Rogers Gardens, and I would like to welcome you to Monarchs and Milkweed, a small education here. I have been completely delighted this morning while we are setting this up to be inundated with monarchs, so I hope you get to see them passing in and out here. I'm right in front of our bird and butterfly garden here. This is our native milkweed growing in back of us. This is the Asclepias fascicularis, and it is the one that we are selling right now. We do have another variety. I'll get to that in a minute. But first, I'd like to talk about monarchs. Monarchs are in the news. Everyone is seriously concerned about them because their numbers have dropped at an alarming rate right now. So what we're doing, and what so many people are doing, is planting milkweed to help them. And to get a really good idea of how this all works, and there are a lot of different opinions and a lot of information, good and bad, out there right now. So I'm gonna try and clarify it and also kind of let you know that there is conflicting information, even from the scientists, about what is best for the monarchs. But I think we can all agree just trying to do the best we can right now is the best effort we can make. So monarchs, basically, to make it easy, we're gonna start in January. January, they come out of their kind of semi-dormant state and they begin breeding. They start getting friendly with each other, and around the end of February to March, they take off. Usually the females start a little bit ahead of the males, but what they're going to do from their breeding grounds, usually along the coast of California. This is Western monarchs, not Eastern monarchs. They have a whole different situation, which I'm not really going to go into right now, but they're basically the same butterfly, just living in different areas. So our Western monarchs live along the coast in the winter. They live very, very close to the coast, and they live in very specific areas. And I urge you all, if you're really interested in the monarchs, to find out where they might be overwintering near you, because that's an important factor in where you're going to be planting milkweed. A lot of people feel you should not plant milkweed near the overwintering sites because it could disturb their overwintering habits. So it's a little complicated, but still, they're going to overwinter in coastal California, within a mile or so of the coast, and then they're going to spend the rest of basically March through September, the end of September, fanning out throughout the western states and a bit of Canada to go and live and to go and search for food, because they haven't really eaten much over the winter. They're going to breed again. They're going to find a place to lay their eggs, and that's where the milkweed comes in. And then, because they all have an assigned destination in their head, they're going to keep going. So it could take generations of the monarchs laying their eggs, caterpillars coming, and then turning into butterflies to get to their final destination before, at the end of the summer, they head back to the coast of California. So when monarchs hatch, so the females go out in March-ish and they lay their eggs on milkweed like this here. And in a couple of days, 3 to 4 days, the eggs will hatch. And this is milkweed, not just narrowleaf milkweed, but the native milkweeds is the only plant that the monarch caterpillars will eat. And it sustains them, and it also gives them a great toxin. That's why they have the beautiful, beautiful colors of a monarch caterpillar, the yellow and black. It's basically kind of a signal to birds, don't eat me because I taste terrible and I'm toxic. That's also why the butterflies have such a strong a color, because they basically tell birds, I taste terrible. So the little eggs are gonna hatch 3 or 4 days. Then they're gonna spend about 2 weeks eating your plants down to the nubs. And then they're going to form a chrysalis. And when they decide to do this, just keep in mind, sometimes they crawl far, far away from the plant. They like to find a safe place. If you see them, you know, going away from your milkweed, let them. Let them go where they need to go, and they will find a spot. And then they're going to form their chrysalis. And again, about 1 to 2 weeks later, all these things depend on the weather, whether it's warm or cool. Warmer will make it happen faster. Cooler, of course, a little bit slower. they're going to form their chrysalis, and then about 2 weeks later, they're going to pop out. So it takes up to about 25 days for the whole egg to butterfly situation to happen. So this is basically the life cycle of a monarch. And then depending on when they're born, so early spring, they're really only going to live maybe a couple of weeks. But if they're born at the end of summer, when they're ready to head back home, these monarchs can live for 6 to 8 months. So they're going to be born in September, and they're going to be the ones who are going to go back to the coastal area for the overwintering and start out again in spring. So it's really fascinating how much detail there is, and I've learned so much about monarchs right now. It's amazing how you can tell the difference between a male and a female, but that is just a lot of information right now. So I'm going to move on to milkweed and why it is important. Again, milkweed is the host plant for monarchs. It is the only plant that they will lay their eggs on. You can see this beautiful milkweed here blooming in back of me, and I think you've seen a couple of butterflies fluttering around. I've kind of seen them out of the corner of my eye. Just this week at Rogers, the butterflies have really come. Every day we probably have about 5 or 10, which is super optimistic for us. This morning while I was setting up, I found this really beautiful old haggard butterfly, which I knew she was probably one of the first ones to come out. So we're selling this milkweed. We want you to get it. We want you to plant it. And we want you to understand a couple of things about it. So first of all, milkweed goes dormant in December. The native milkweed does. And it's really important that it goes dormant because it signals to the butterflies, move along. And so if you're raising milkweed and you have caterpillars and everything like that, and they eat it down to the nubs, let them move on. Let whatever happens, happens, because you have milkweed, it's planted, and it will leaf out again. We just need to keep the cycle going, and they have to keep moving. Monarchs aren't meant to stay in one place, really, except for during their overwintering time. They're meant to travel. Maybe the ones in your garden are heading to the Rockies. We don't know. They could be Colorado or Utah or Oregon. So just let it go and make sure that you're just planting milkweed and making sure that they're happy and doing their thing. So the milkweed, they don't emerge from their dormancy until it's pretty warm. So you've noticed if you've been trying to buy milkweed at Rogers, we've had a little here, a little there, but now we have a ton of it because it's warm enough. The milkweed is growing, and this is the time to get, sorry, I'm gonna stop for a second.
Continue now.
Oh, now I can continue. Okay, so, with the milkweed, because it's so warm now, it is growing like crazy, and this is the great time. It's not that growers weren't ready, it's not that we weren't ready, it's just that it needs to be a natural kind of progression so that it's best for the monarchs. And if you have that tropical milkweed in your garden and you're thinking, well, you know, I have monarchs all year round, There is a backside to that, and all I can say is we encourage you to pull out that tropical milkweed. Come on into Rogers. We'll exchange one per address, a free milkweed plant for one of your tropical milkweeds, and you can also stock up on more the native milkweed plants. It's just the tropical milkweed, it holds a protozoan disease in it, and it's called OE. I can't remember the name of it. We just call it OE, but it is really, really bad for the monarchs. It's not the only thing that's bad for the monarchs. Things like pesticides are bad for the monarchs. And so climate change is bad for them. There's a multitude of things that are combining to create this really big problem with the monarchs. So we just have to do the best we can. We just found out yesterday that all of our milkweed is pesticide-free, so no neonicotinoids and no BT sprayed on them. We are adamant with our growers, and it has been a process, so we just want you to know the milkweed that you buy here today, you can immediately set out in your garden and feed your caterpillars, so everything's going to be good with that. Okay, that being said, I mentioned earlier about not planting milkweed in the overwintering spot. So even if it's summer, You don't really want to plant the milkweed in the overwintering spots. And so if you go online, there are a lot of sites that'll show you if you are near an overwintering spot. Down here in super Southern California, most of the overwintering spots will start about in Santa Barbara and go up to San Francisco and things like that. But there are a couple spots here, and they advise us to not plant milkweed within about 4 to 5 miles of an overwintering spot. So check the internet, see if you're going to be in that area. And then if you can't plant milkweed, or if you shouldn't plant milkweed where you are, there are so many other great things you can do to help monarchs, which is you can plant food for them. Things like this yarrow, the achillea, is a great butterfly food. We have other natives, like this beautiful buckwheat, which looks just like milkweed in its bloom, sort of. And then, of course, the number one plant that is just gorgeous, and so many butterflies love this as a nectar and a food source, it's called butterfly bush. This is Buddleia, and this is just gonna bloom all summer long. So if you think that maybe milkweed isn't the right thing for your area, just plant food, and you will still have tons of butterflies in your garden, not just monarchs, because the milkweed is only going to bring the monarchs in. But if you plant food for the butterflies, you'll have swallowtails, and you'll have the gulf fritillaries and things like that. So create an entire pollinator garden with butterflies and hummingbirds and bees and everything. So that's about it. I'm going to open this up to some questions. I feel like we probably have some.
So one person asked, thank you for the information, Suzanne. One person asked, they planted milkweed and got a ton of eggs to mm-hmm. the point they think it's too many eggs for the milkweed. How do they avoid that?
You can't. The butterflies, they'll lay between 200 and 500 eggs in the 2 week period that they are laying eggs. And so it's that whole circle of life situation where maybe they lay a lot of eggs and some of them survive and some of them don't. You can really rarely have enough milkweed to keep up with all of the caterpillars that might be laid on there, but you can make some of them survive. And so if you get 5 monarchs out of your plants, that is so much better than 0. So it's really, really good, and it's kind of accepting the facts, but it's difficult. It's difficult. Oh, goodness me. So our butterfly almost killed Marissa there.
About the winter, like winter area to plant it, where can you find out about that area?
Oh, so I yesterday kind of Googled something. And so I have, this is where to see monarchs in California. I can't remember the exact website, but it tells you the selected sites. And I was surprised that Huntington Beach actually has one. Most of the sites where they overwinter are private property, but there are a couple places where you can. Like I said, here, if you're within a mile or two of the coast, check. If you're further inland, you don't really have to worry. Plant your milkweed, plant your butterfly foods, and oh my gosh, thank you so much. Look at that. We only paid her $20 to show up, and she did. So it's been so exciting doing all this. This is just so much fun. So yeah, just a check around. It's pretty easy. You can say Google Western Monarch overwintering sites, and it'll show you. There's a couple of them, really, really good sites. The Xerces Society, that's Xerces Society, has so much information. They're just a wealth of information.
Okay. Does native milkweed have pods like tropical milkweed?
They have seed pods like that, yes. And they will spread out. And the best thing to do, if you can, is collect the seeds, let the seed pods dry, let them just about split open, and then you can plant the seeds. They're fairly easy to grow. You want to just put them down about a half an inch, cover them with some soil, and make sure that they're kind of like lightly moist until they germinate. Then they're pretty easy. You can put them in little starter pots. You can put them in the ground, but the more milkweed, the better. So it's basically free milkweed if you let your plants go to seed.
Are ladybugs good to be around milkweed?
They are, and they will have a tendency to hang around a little bit. Milkweed, I didn't even go into all the little fun things that go along with milkweed, which are oleander aphids. They're the orange aphid that you see on your milkweed. It's a conundrum because you have to decide, how do I get rid of them? Because they can take a lot of life from the plant, just sucking, but you can squish them. I would say put on gloves and kind of squish them carefully. You can try and spray them off with a hose, but try not to use any sort of pesticides, because what kills good bugs also kills bad bugs, also kills good bugs. There's also like little, what do we call them? Love bugs that go on milkweed as well. They're little black and red bugs. So you get the aphids, you get the black and red love bugs, you get the caterpillars, you get bees going on there. I mean, it's really fun to watch. And most of these bugs, by the way, these aphids stay on your milkweed. They're not gonna spread all over. They're super specific.
Someone asked, what actually is the red bug that loves milkweed?
I can't remember what they're called. We call them little love bugs because they're stuck together a lot. So I'll try and find that out, and I'll put it at the bottom in the comments.
What does tropical milkweed look like, and how do I know if I have it?
Tropical milkweed is easy to distinguish. If it has yellow or orange or red flowers, super bright, bright flowers, it's tropical. You can see the native. It's this beautiful kind of creamy white with the pink centers. It is gorgeous, just gorgeous. And then we also have another variety here at Rogers, the Areocarpa, which is what is called the showy milkweed. Hello. Showy milkweed. Showy milkweed has a bigger, fatter leaf. It's very fuzzy and super, super cool flowers. So that's another good one. It's a little bit more expensive. It's $19.99 for the little 6-inch container, whereas all of our other milkweed is $16.99. And believe me, we have enough. We have so much milkweed. We're so happy, and we're continuing to get it. So there's no lack of milkweed here.
Do aphids eat other plants like plumerias?
Oh yeah, aphids can be on a lot of different plants, but the ones that are specific to the milkweed are those little orange oleander aphids. So that's aphids and spring, they go together just like this.
Okay.
I can't get over how many monarchs are just tooting around here. It's really fun. It is the time.
I think that might be all the questions.
Okay. I have a ton more information, so if you have more questions, just ask them. It has been so much fun learning more about milkweed and monarchs and their relationship together. So as I've learned how to tell a male monarch from a female, and just so many beautiful things. But that's going to be it for me today. Don't forget to tune in on Thursday. I think Sarah's doing the plant of the week. And go to our rogersgardens.com page. You can go to Instagram and Facebook and our YouTube channel. Be sure and subscribe, and you can come and see all of the videos that we have. And that's it for me. I'll be back next week.